First time we met was at a party, but I had seen you around campus playing with your electric, your big rockin' electric band.
Yeah, I had a honkin' rock band. It was pretty rad.
I knew that you played guitar, and I was looking for someone to play guitar to fill in for a gentleman who graduated that I used to play with. And I said, hey, Matt, do you want to come down and jam? And he was like, wow, I can just carry my acoustic guitar down instead of bringing all this gear in and make a very small amount of money and have a lot of fun.
We went down to Dylan's Cafe, and I just brought my acoustic guitar, and I just followed your hands because I didn't know the songs.
Well, we used to play a handful of covers. It was about 50-50. We played about 50% covers and 50% of our own stuff because we didn't have that much.
Well, and also bars wouldn't book us. They were like, well, do you play other people's music or do you play your music? And we'd always say, well, we play other people's music so we could get the gig, and then we'd sneak in our own.
Nobody
tunes.
Wants to hear original songs.
No, not when you're starting out.
Not at like nickel beer night, you know, they don't want
and
that.
Now some of our friends who are doing the same kind of thing, who are playing in bands and bars, are playing our music.
Yeah. I have more than one friend that's out there doing exactly what you guys did. Yeah. They're playing Vertical Horizon.
Yeah, so figure. Cool. So cool. Back the tears when they need it. We had achieved a certain amount of success around campus at Georgetown. The show started getting bigger, more people were coming out, and we had more opportunities. So we realized that we had something special. So we said, hey, you know, we've graduated from college, let's reward ourselves. Do a little recording now and see what comes up. So we said, hey, let's take a shot. Let's go up to Cape Cod for the summer and relax and write some songs. And then we went into to Matt's old high school and recorded the first album.
We learned how to use the studio while we were making There and Back Again, our first record. So, you know, we'd look at the knobs and I'd say, well, what the hell does this do? And then, you know, that's a cool knob, you know, okay, more, that's more.
We had to live on the floor of the studio. The studio was probably about the size of this room. And for the last 4 days, you know, the studio did not have a shower. So it got a little ripe.
It was definitely ripe.
Oh yeah.
You can hear that. I think it comes through in the music.
Hey, you really can.
Yeah. There's an urgency.
There is. Let's get out of here.
Let's get a freaking shower. I remember Matt and I, it was the first time we really sat down and, you know, produced these albums together. And but mostly that whole thing, I just remember Matt being in the room, like the board where you recorded faced the window, you know, the studio where you would sing and record. And so we pretty much just sat and stared at each other for 12 days straight.
And you can hear that in the record.
Yes,
too.
You can. We spent 2 years in DC touring around, and then luckily, a band called Jacko Pierce, a duo from Dallas, Texas, they heard the album and really liked it. So they asked us to go out on the road with them.
We got the band together. That was our first time as a band and toured around the country. And we didn't, you know, we didn't have a sound man or anything like that. We were touring. We had two trucks. You know, I had an Explorer and you had a Jeep. And we would follow each other around the country. I mean, that's how bad it was.
And then we finally sold enough albums that we were able to graduate to an RV.
Okay, so now you have all this room, this space. But I was scared shitless in the RV for 3 years.
And you know why? Because they do not require you to have any special license to drive an RV. They should.
I mean,
there were five of us with regular licenses driving a 30-foot Class A RV. You know, not like one of these, you know? And we had many brushes with death.
I remember whenever a semi would pass the RV, the walls of the RV would flex open and you could see air coming into the RV. Yeah. You know, if you were sitting in one of the chairs and if you had hair, it would flow this way.
Right.
Yeah. I blew it up once. Yeah. I drove it into a swimming pool once as well. A little Keith Moon action there. But literally, I like forgot to hit the parking brake. And I was like on the pool and we were all having a good time, having cocktails. And all of a sudden somebody just went, hey, look, and there comes the RV like downhill. The dream, of course, but and into the swimming pool. And me just going, what am I going to say to the guys?
Woohoo, let's party.
I was in a sports store one day with a football helmet in my hand on the checkout line, ready to buy it so that I could sleep in the football helmet, mm-hmm. because that's how scared I was of sleeping in
this thing.
There
were other hazards too. Like in the beginning, we didn't have a trailer for it, so we kept the kick drum wrapped in a towel in the shower.
Yeah, it was in the shower.
We kept the bass amp like in the only place that there was sort of extra room. So if somebody slammed on the brakes like that, bass amp just went flying.
Yeah.
So, you know, it was definitely a very combustible and dangerous situation. At some point during the RV adventure, we built up enough of a following in Texas that we took the ball and ran with it and started headlining down there. And I think we did that for probably about 6 months, and then we started realizing that we just wanted more dynamics on stage and we wanted more excitement.
And I remember thinking, you know, we're trying so hard to simulate something that, you know, is the only way we're going to solve this is by bringing in a drummer and a bass player. We had toured for There and Back Again and decided when we were going into to make Running on Ice, I remember Heart in Hand was a tune in particular that we were listening to and thinking, man, you know, drums and bass would sound really good on that tune. So we decided, okay, well, we'll record the record as if we're a band and then we'll worry about what we're going to do after, you know, we'll worry about that later. So we got Carter Beaufort from Dave Matthews came in and played amazing. He's such an amazing drummer. And while we were making Running on Ice, I remember a lot of times we would go into the studio for a day or two and we would spend all the money that we had. So we'd have to go back out on the road afterwards. And that, for that reason, Running on Ice took us an awfully long time to make. You know, we would do it in spurts, and once we had the money, we'd go back into the studio and then go back out on the road.
We finally finished Running on Ice after over a year, and we released the album, and we said, all right, we need to go start touring everywhere that we can and sell this album. So we did that, which was very similar to the first album, but we did, we had to find a band to tour with.
Working for Borders up in Massachusetts, and I remember one day this record came in with this big VH on it, you know, Vertical Horizon, Running on Ice, and my boss and I are looking at this thing like, they're gonna get sued, Van Halen, you know, this is kind of laughing at them almost, like, you know, what this possible, you know, this is a total rip, it can't possibly be any good, put it on the shelf, you know. So like 2 days after this, Matt's mom is in our store. At some point she had said, oh yeah, this is my son's band, you know, from Worcester, and oh great, oh, they're playing in town tonight. About a half an hour later, Matt calls the store and talks to my boss, a guy named Dave, and Dave comes up to me and says, yeah, remember that Van Halen, that mother was in here? Well, the guy like called me up and put me on the guest list for the show tonight. You wanna go? And I was like, yeah, you know, give me a call when we get out of here or whatever. And still, this is kind of funny to me. I had to be talked into going out that night by my wife. Like, I got home from work, I was kind of beat. It was like, yeah, there's a band playing at Mamakin, we're on the list. I really don't feel like going out. And she kind of said, look, you've been talking about meeting people on the scene and going to see bands, it's a free ticket, just go. And I was like, all right, I'll go. So I went down there and saw the band, and I really, and I'm not saying it because they're sitting right next to me, but I really sort of instantly took to the music. While I was there, I ran into a friend of mine named Jason. So he said, hey, this band's looking for a drummer. You should give him a call, get in touch. And I said, great. And I ended up just putting a tape together and sending it out to Matt on the road.
We had like a 3-week tour planned. And Ed had called us up, knew that we were looking for a drummer. And we sent him the CDs. And you and Matt, I think, had been talking. And so we said, all right, well, we're going to go do this trio tour. Just bass and guitars and vocals, and when we come back, we'll audition you.
So 3 weeks had gone by, and at this point, I knew this CD like the back of my hand because I'd been listening to it at home and really knew the tunes well. And I went over to Matt's mom's house again, the mom, and set up. And I was really kind of excited because the first couple things that we played were new songs. I think they were what turned out to be "Promise of Tomorrow" and "The Ride."
I remember when we started playing the stuff on "Running on Ice." You and I were not playing the same thing that Ed was. And he's like, no, that's not what you did on the record.
Yeah, oh yeah. And we couldn't remember what the original arrangement was.
Yeah, we couldn't remember, and he was correcting us. So we knew, first of all, that we were psyched, that he was so like into the music.
And second of all, that we were going to have a really, really hard time with him in the theater.
I joined in March of 96, and we toured throughout the summer. We took a little break. We went back out on the road, and in September, we recorded two shows at Ziggy's in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, that became the Live Stages record. So within like 6 months, I was in this band, and now we were making a record, you know? And even though it was a live record, it was still, for me, it was like my first full-length recording. So we did those shows, and I just remember those being great with the hurricane.
They were great. Yeah, there was a hurricane that took place. So I remember the first night, I think that there were around 950 people there, which is close to capacity. And I just remember there was a seam in one of the in the tarps where three tarps met, and there was a constant just fall
drip,
of water. It wasn't even a drip, it was a fall of water. And I remember looking out at some point and seeing this 17-year-old redheaded kid, and it was the only place that he could find room to watch the show, and water was just pouring on him all night long. And it did not get
him
down.
And he did not move at all.
One bit, yeah. The next night we had a sold-out crowd, and that was really, really a special night. I think one of the better shows that we played as a band, and Live Stages came out of it.
Our making a live record was a very purposeful maneuver on our part. We had been trying to gain the interest of major labels, and it's very hard when, you know, there's so many bands out there to get people to pay attention to you. And so we became a bit frustrated when, you know, after Running on Ice, people weren't knocking down our doors. And so we said, you know what, let's step back and let's look at what our real strengths are. And we came up with, our live show is good and people really like coming to see us play, so let's make a live record. And yeah, it might be a bit ballsy for a pretty, you know, fairly unestablished band to put a live record out there, but we felt that it would be our best sort of calling card to the majors. So we decided, okay, we'll make a live record and then we'll send that to the record companies and see what they say. And so when you listen to Live Stages, the beginning of the record, the first thing you hear essentially is the crowd singing. That again was very purposeful. It was, okay, that we can imagine the A&R guy puts it into a CD player, the first thing he hears is not the band singing, but the crowd singing, because they know the songs and love the songs.
I was blown away at the amount of people that were at the club and the fact that they all knew all the words, even like the Japanese lyrics in Japan, and they sang along almost sometimes louder than the band, and it was like, who are these guys?
Yeah, we wanted to capture that on tape, and I think Live Stages does that very well. And then we did, we sent that around eventually to the majors, and
it worked.
Yeah, it did work.
It was about that time that we started talking to the labels that, ironically enough, our bass player decided to leave. RCA became the label that we sort of warmed up to the most.
They'd seen the amount of work that we had done, and they were very respectful and said, okay, we appreciate what you have done and we value that, so we'll come together much more as a partnership than in the traditional sense of, you know, the A&R guy discovers this little, you know, young tyke who then signs his life away.
And at this point we needed to get a bass player, so we started the audition process.
Late 97, I hear, yeah, a friend of mine from Worcester, some guy I was playing with, tells me, yeah, I know this guy, he's living in New York, but he's from Worcester, and he's part of a band, and they just got a record deal. Nobody gets a record deal if they're from Worcester. It just doesn't happen. You know? Massachusetts, unless you're in Boston, it's not really a hotbed of musical activity. But I was playing around town and always on the lookout for that gig, and all of a sudden, out of thin air comes, the band I told you about, they got a deal. They just happen to need a bass player. And then after the audition, we all hit it off well, and you're like, well, you're the first guy,
yeah.
So we got a few more to see, and, you know, thanks for coming in, but good luck
to you. Totally, we'll be in touch.
And, right,
and yeah, we talked about that. We were like, well, we all really like this guy, and it felt good, but there's no way that the first guy is going to be it.
Finally, you know, everybody okayed it, and then we started working on some new tunes. Again, like Ed, like throwing out some new ideas, and that one was Finding Me, I remember, but we didn't, didn't have a title for it yet. You know, May, we started doing pre-production at that little studio in
Boston, Cambridge. Yeah.
And then we started making the record in June. And I had done one gig at that point. And we just started working on the new record. So
you were tired. You needed a break.
I needed to get in and sit down and play. Right. I was tired of standing in front of the huge crowds.
Yeah, of course you were.
And that's when it's funny to learn about a band in the studio.
Yeah.
To like learn how to play together. And that's why the next record is going to be so different, because it's been 3 years of all of us playing together and really knowing how to work together.
A lot more. We're going to do a lot more of the show tune.
Polka.
Yeah, well, now we know our likes and dislikes, so I know I can bust out, you know, Hello Dolly.
Yes, I know Hello Dolly.
And we might do that as a cover.
Dude, you know Hello Dolly.
I do. It's my favorite of all the...
And you nail it every time.
And we knew that the next studio record we were going to make was going to be more of a rock record. You know, we had been playing the old songs in a bit more of a rock fashion. You know, I'd been playing electric guitar, so it did serve as sort of a
bridge.
Yeah, a bridge. Thank you. Between Running on Ice and what eventually was going to be Everything You Want, it had been something that I had done since I was 13 years old. So for me, when we went into the studio to make Everything You Want, I felt like, okay, this is the record that I've always wanted to make. The first thing I remember about going in to make Everything You Want is that we had time for pre-production. And we went to a small studio in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and we spent, I don't know, 8 hours a day or something for about a week or so in this little studio. And it was just the four of us working out the arrangements of the songs. But that felt really cool. So that was a huge difference from our independent records. With the indie records, it was like, get in and go. There's no time for, you know, screwing around. Put the red light on, let's go. It was much more relaxed. It was much more about the music. Let's go in when the songs are ready. So we spent that week in Cambridge and then
headed down to Bearsville.
To Bearsville. Yeah.
We banged out the tracks there, and then we moved to
Water
Music in Hoboken, and started working on guitars.
When we were recording the bass line for Finding Me, we had recorded a very straight bass line, and it was really on my insistence in a way. I was saying, you know, I really hear this for this tune. And as we'd spent more time with it, I realized, and I think we all realized, that maybe that wasn't the right way to go.
And somebody had brought up the idea of like, well, you know, maybe we should redo the bass line.
I remember
Sean was in Hoboken with like 101 degree fever, just totally laid out. And I remember watching sort of on the sidelines, Mark call him up.
I called him up.
Yeah.
Oh, you called him up.
Matt called him up
and said, we hate to do this to you, dude, but can you get on the PATH train?
Get out of bed.
And yeah, totally woke him up, the whole thing. Get on the PATH train, come over here, and it easily had to have been midnight or 1.
Yeah, definitely. By the time I got there, it was midnight. Yeah. I remember getting the call and was like, you know, how are you doing, Sean? Oh, I'm not doing great. Thanks for asking.
Yeah,
you know, my job's
in,
done.
Right.
You guys are mixing. Glad to know you still care.
Right.
How are you guys doing? Well, we need you to come down. We really want to have this track. It wasn't a priority track, but for some reason it's rocking, but it's not rocking. We need you to just redo something. We need you. It was like, someone needs to save this track, and we voted on you to save it.
It's you. We knew it was you. I mean, and that was the thing. And you jumped on the train, and I remember, well, you can probably tell better.
Well, I hopped on the train thinking, how am I going to do this? Where am I going? How can I get there? Like, I didn't even know where I was, really. I think I had my bass with me. Mm-hmm. And I was just thinking, all right, there's got to be some moments I'm playing the song in my head, and I thought of the line that I thought would be, like, the go-getter line. And we got there, and I just said, all right, just erase the other bass track, let me play. And pretty much what I played was what's on the record, and I just did a couple other fix-it spots.
You were in for, like, a half hour, and you were back on the next train out. And so that's, to me, that's a perfect example of you just coming in. And that was, but you know, buddy, we need you. Sorry.
That's just doing my job. I think that's what excites me about the band, is like, if we can all just do what comes naturally, it usually excites everyone else. And that's the beauty.
Yeah.
When you do something that excites you, we all get excited about it. And that's why, you know, after X number of years, we all still want to be in the band.
Totally. Right? We Are was a song that I had started working on. You know, sometimes songs come together very quickly. Everything You Want was a song that came together very quickly. In other songs, it is like you have to give birth to them. It's like, man, I worked on We Are for a long time. I remember feeling like I had bits and pieces of it for over a year. And the thing that I was missing were the verses. I had the chorus or the hook of the We Are. I thought that was cool. And then as we were getting closer and closer to the record, it was pissing me off so much that I didn't have verses for this thing that one night when I had gone up to Massachusetts to record demos for the record, I just sat down and I said, I am writing this goddamn song right now. And I just wrote down, take a listen, you know, through the window, take a lover on the radio, and I just started going. For me, once it started flowing, it really flowed, but I have so many rough drafts of that song that are terrible, you know, and sometimes you just have to work on them like that.
We had released everything as a single in like November of 99, and it didn't hit until like June of 2000, so I just remember these months of us out on the road slagging it off, like, is this gonna happen? Are we gonna end up in the cutout bin and dropped after one record? And then almost overnight, it went from, I've never heard Everything You Want on the radio, to it's everywhere I go. It's in restaurants, and I'm getting phone calls from everybody I know. I've heard your song.
Hockey games.
Oh my God, yeah. Baseball. Yeah. I mean, it was just everywhere.
We really try and write lyrics that we believe in. We wanna, because you know, I know how I feel now singing this record 3 years into it. I still believe in all the songs from the record. And if I had written something that was just a sort of flighty little pop ditty that I don't really care about, by now I'd be sick of it. But every time we start Everything You Want, I feel like I just wrote
Plus,
it.
Plus it'll disappear too. I think you can look at this song from this album from a lyrical standpoint, and all these words will resonate 10 years down the line. Because people will still be talking about communicating with each other and relationships and those kind of things.
We became a band that people had heard of, finally. Yeah. And we graduated up from the van to the bus. It was like, when are we going to get a bus? And they, you know, the answer is, well, when you have a hit.
Writing You're a God, I had played it for my brother really early on. My brother, in addition to the guys in the band, my brother has always been someone that I've played my music for, and he's been a great sounding board. And it was this, the verses were this different chord progression. It was all so kind of cryptic and complicated. And then the chorus came in, and the chorus was the same. It was cool. I remember my brother said, you know, why don't you just keep it simple? Just play the same, you know, chord progression essentially throughout the whole song. And I said, you can't do that. You can't do that, right? My brother's name is Ryan. And I said, well, okay, well, maybe you can do it. And I started playing it. And the verse, the chords in the verse are the same as the chords in the chorus. And a lot of pop songs have used that, and it's a very effective tool. It's the first time that I had really done that before. The verses then, when I started working from that perspective, really came out quickly and easily, and I felt the song was much better as a result. So I have to thank my brother. Thanks, Ryan. As we go into the studio to make this next record, there are things that have been with us since we started as a band and as a duo, you know, solid, good songs that we believe in, that we know mean something to us, that we can play hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times and still mean. Those kinds of things will not go away, and that we will see that in our next record. Whether or not it'll sound exactly like Everything You Want, well, I hope it doesn't. I hope it sounds like a progression. I hope it sounds like this is a band that's capable of growth.
Everybody says, well, what's it gonna sound like, you know? We really don't know. It's too early to tell. You know, we haven't been playing any of this stuff live yet, and we're gonna take a little vacation and come together and, you know, throw the songs into the pot just the way we did last time. Feels sort of very much more like a band now, simply because Sean joined just as we were going into the studio for everything, and I think it's going to be really fun and interesting to go through the whole process again. I'm looking forward to it.
You know, no one knows what the future will bring, but I can say that
the Love Boat theme will
be on the
make
next
an appearance on the next record.
But just saying. I think that with the next album that we do, who knows what it'll sound like, but I do know that at the end of it, the end of the day when we're listening to it for the first time together, that we'll be proud of it, or it'll never see the light of day.
Right.
And I think that, you know, the next videos that we make will be the same thing, and I'm sure we'll do some international touring and some domestic touring, and the whole time we're just going to try and get better as a band and as people and try and have as much fun as we can, so come along.